بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله تعالى، نحمده ونستعينه ونستهديه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا وسيئات أعمالنا، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم. I do welcome everyone with another journey with one of the prophets, one of the messengers, one of the messengers of the messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he was a messenger at one certain time, and he's one of the companions of the Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. He has special features that no other Sahabi shared him in. Special features that no other Sahabi shared him in, and he's the only one who had that. And the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم gave him a special position that was known among all the Sahaba. And this Sahabi radiallahu anhu, when I was preparing, talking about him, I was reading and listening and collecting information about him. I listed down some of the features of this Sahabi and in his personality, which I counted around 10 of the features that will shed light on different sides of the personality of this Sahabi, in addition to the unique, special features that no one else shared him with. In addition to that, which you will mention, he had 10 other features in his personality that would leave us with a sense of subhanAllah. This man was very unique, that he should give a role model for everyone of us, and he should inspire many of us. So we could get lessons out of his life a lot till Yawm al-Qiyamah. This Sahabi radiallahu anhu, no one can say he's a Muhajiri or Ansari. And so you cannot classify him whether among the Muhajirin or the Ansar, because he has linkage with both the Muhajirin and Ansar. Even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him the choice when he asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, should I be an Ansari or Muhajiri? Should I be counted on this side or this side? He said, it's up to you. You could be either one of them because of your special case. And at the end, he chose to be from the Ansar. So, at the end, he chose radiallahu anhu to be one of the Ansar, one of the people who did help the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that Sahaba who came migrated from Mecca in the Medina radiallahu anhu. But he has a linkage to both sides radiallahu anhu. Whenever the Sahaba is mentioned, Al-Ahzab, Ghazwat al-Ahzab is mentioned. The battle of bar parties or ditch is mentioned. Whenever this Sahab is mentioned, the hypocrites are mentioned. And I'm giving you a clue now for what's the feature, the feature that he's given, that no other Sahabi was given this feature, the hypocrites. And this Sahabi is the only one among the thousands of the Sahaba of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who was entrusted in a secret. And this secret is the secret which just one man was aware of. And this secret has been communicated to him from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam by himself alayhi salatu wasalam, mouth to ear sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to this Sahabi. This is the list of the this list of the hypocrites in the Medina was given to him radiallahu anhu arda by the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This is a list of all the hypocrites who used to live in the Medina claiming that they are Muslims, while in the heart they are not Muslims. They are just took this position in order to protect themselves from the Muslims who came to Medina, who used to be from the people of Medina, and following Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the master of the Medina, whom the people of Aus and Khazraj, both of them, the two major tribes of Medina, were about to crown him as their king, as the king who will, both of them will be underneath his kingdom. But when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Al-Madinah, they gave the allegiance to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the leader. So Ibn Salul felt the hate in the heart from the heart to Muhammad and Islam, but he was not able to announce that publicly. So he claimed that I am a Muslim. While in the heart, he's hiding the hate, and he conspired against the Islam and the Muslims in many counts. And one of them was in the parties or the ditch, the battle of ditch, battle of the Ahzab, with the people of Quraysh. When they, and the other one with the people of the Jewish Banu Qurayda, who were used to live out at the outskirts of the Medina, and the Munafiqeen conspired with them for the defeat of the Muslims. And with him, with Abdullah ibn ibn Salul, and there are many others from the people of Medina, he used to have the same quality, which is the hypocrisy. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, although he was aware of by name, he did not disclose their names, so he will not spread the internal conflict between the Muslims, because they the same hypocrite, munafiq, used to have a very devout Muslim. Abdullah ibn Ubay ibn Salul, the head of the hypocrites, he used to have Abdullah ibn Abdullah, his son, who was one of the very devout Muslims, very wonderful Muslims. And although his father was the head of the hypocrites, the son was used to be a wonderful Sahabi. And there are many like that. And he, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, never gave the name or disclosed any of the names of these people to anyone, in order to keep the peace and the tranquility in the Medina, leaving their affairs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take care of. Leaving their matters to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take care of. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will protect the Muslims, and none of them will be able to conspire to bring real harm. They might be annoying. They might have some kind of bad influence, but at the end of the day, Allah's command is prevailing. So he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave this list of the names of the hypocrites to just one person, who is our character today, Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman radiallahu anhu arda. Hudhayfa ibn Yaman radiallahu anhu arda, the man who had the list of the hypocrites of the Medina, and he never disclosed this list to anyone. He wasn't trusted on by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he respected this trust that many occasions he was in a test that whether he will say who is hypocrite, who is not, but he never disclosed it in order to keep it, to keep the same trust that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It's not only that, but another quality for Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu arda, his awareness of the heart and the ills of the heart, and how to fix your heart, and how the hypocrisy or the nifaq or the kufr that would come, would sneak into your heart, and what are the different kinds of the hearts, and the different the heart of the kuffar disbelievers, how would it be, and what kind of ills are we're talking about, believing ills and moral ills, what kind of what the heart of the hypocrite will have, what the heart of the real Muslim will have, what the heart of the struggling Muslim, meaning the Muslim who is sometimes good and many times are bad, like many of us, most of us. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to move our hearts from this kind to the kind of pure heart of the real Muslim. He, radiallahu anhu arda, was very much aware of the, he was not a cardiologist, but he was the scholar who of the hearts. How to fix, how to clean, and how to purify your heart from the all kinds and all sorts and all reasons of the hypocrisy, and all reasons of the illness of the heart, radiallahu anhu. These are two of the major qualities and neat qualities for Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, radiallahu anhu. Hudhayfa, radiallahu anhu, has a lot of advantages and characteristics. We'll move with that, inshallah, with the time. But let me give you quickly a brief background about Hudhayfa, which will show us why he could be considered as a muhajir, or could be considered as an ansari, and why he has a relationship with both the Muhajirin and the Ansar. Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, his father, radiallahu anhu arda, is called Husayl ibn Jabir, and originally they are from Mecca. Husayl ibn Jabir, his father, used to be from Makkah, but he killed a man, he killed a man from the people of Makkah, so he left and fled from Makkah, going to Yathrib in order to be protected and not to be killed for the killing he did. It was before Islam. So he left, he went to Yathrib, which used to be in Yathrib, and after that Medina Munawwara, where the Muslims migrated after that, and he was under the protection, he has and a kind of alliance with one of the tribes of Yathrib, which is Bani al-Ashhal, one of the tribes of Yathrib, and this is a tribe of Sa'd ibn Mu'adh radiallahu anhu arda, and they took him under their protection. It was used to be known as the Ahd wal-Mu'ahada, the alliance and the protection. When you give a protection to someone and you declare it, Mahmud is under my protection, it means if anyone will harm him, I am responsible to protect him. So people used to highly consider the issue of the protections and the alliances, because this is a very important issue in the Arab at the time. So he was in the protection and alliance of Bani Abd al-Ashhal, one of the tribes of the Yathrib. So he felt comfortable by being in Yathrib, but his origin is from Mecca. When he went to Yathrib, he married from one of the ladies who after that became the mother of Hudhaifa radiallahu anhu arda, and Safwan. Hudhaifa and Safwan, two of the sons of Husayl ibn Jabir. And Hudhaifa grew up in Yathrib radiallahu anhu arda. So Hudhaifa grew up in a house that used to be very affectionate house, very loving house, and a very comfortable house, till Husayl heard about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the man who he is the last prophet and messenger in Mecca. And so himself and Sa'd ibn Mu'adh and Usayd ibn Hudayr from the same tribe went to Yathrib, spoke to Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and accepted Islam. So Husayl accepted Islam, the father of Hudhaifa radiallahu anhu arda. Hudhaifa did not join them in this tribe, but Hudhaifa after that believed in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam before seeing him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Husayl, his father, the father of Hudhaifa, came back to Al-Madinah believing, and his household, all of them, his wife as well, believed in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and his children believed in Muhammad. So Hudhaifa ibn al-Yaman did not face the struggle and the for being Muslim from the very beginning. His house was a Muslim house. He did not face the troubles that Bilal faced. He did not face even the troubles that Ammar or any of the Sahaba, Sa'd ibn Abu Waqqas, any of the Sahaba faced by accepting Islam, because his house, his mother and the father, radiallahu anhu ardhan, used to be Muslims and well protected in their society. Subhanallah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Bilal and Sa'd and Mus'ab ibn Umair and all of these Sahaba radhiyallahu alayhim the thawab and the ajr for facing the troubles of accepting Islam and facing all of this heat. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved Hudhaifa from that. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Hudhaifa something else to make it up for him, radiallahu anhu arda. And this something else, one of them was the trust that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave him. And not only that, but I will mention a story right now in the battle of the ditch that made Hudhaifa, radiallahu anhu arda, yawm al-qiyamah, in the company of Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it for him for what he did in the battle of the ditch, Ghazwat al-Ahzab, radiallahu anhu arda. Moving back to Hudhaifa and his coming. So Hudhaifa grew up in Medina, while his ancestors and his origins from Mecca, and this is why he has a relationship in both Mecca and the Medina. And this is why when Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated to Mecca, and Hudhaifa met him, the son, Hudhaifa came to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and told him, "Ya Rasulullah, am I Ansari or Muhajiri?" And he sallallahu alaihi wasallam told him that it's up to you. You could be one, you could be both, but it's up to you. And he said, "I would prefer Al-Ansar, the people I grew up in with, and the place I grew up in. I have the affection, I have the relationship in the place I grew up in." So there is nothing. So long as you grew up in an area that gave you the freedom to practice your deen and they embraced you and supported you, there is nothing wrong that you will feel that you are attached to it and you love it and you feel that I'm comfortable to be part of it. My forefathers were from Mecca, but I grew up in Yathrib. So I'm Ansari and Hudhaifa choose to be Ansari. So raise up your head. If you are a Muslim born in the States, while your origins are from Pakistan or from India or from the peninsula or from Africa or from, don't feel that you are troubled, torn apart between the two entities. No. There is nothing wrong with that. Hudhaifa used to feel that he has lineage in Mecca. At the same time, he grew up in Yathrib. So even though he chose to be Yathribi, Ansari, رجل عنه أرضاه. So رجل عنه and Hudhaifa, who gave us the example for every Muslim young, the Muslim generation, the young generations who grew up in an area, another area that that's different from their ancestors, and they are still struggling between the entity and the identity. You should not struggle in this identity. إن الأرض لله يورثها من يشاء من عباده والعاقبة للمتقين. At the end of Surah Al-Qasas, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it clear that the earth is to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All the earth belongs to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He will give it in inherit it to whoever he will give it to from his عباد. يورثها من يشاء من عباده. And be one of this عباد to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will inherit you this earth. You were born in Illinois. You were born in the city of Chicago. You were born in Wisconsin. You were born whatever. You feel the attachment to it. That's fine. There is nothing wrong with that. Alhamdulillah, you feel that you are practicing your deen freely and openly. And so this is my city. This is my state. This is my country. Feel it, and feel proud that alhamdulillah you have the ability to practice your deen freely, like Hudhaifa رجل عنه هذا. He chose to be Ansari رجل عنه هذا. Hudhaifa رجل عنه هذا, there are two, whenever Hudhaifa is mentioned, I said there are two incidents who are mentioned. The first one, which you mentioned, the names of the hypocrites. The second one, which is the battle of the ditch, or the غزوة الأحزاب, or غزوة الخندق, or غزوة the battle of the parties, or the battle of the ditch, or الأحزاب والخندق. Because Hudhaifa رجل عنه أرضاه, in this غزوة, in this battle, he did something that he was choosing to for it. He was chosen first, before that, to be entrusted on the name of the hypocrites by Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. As well, by Rasulullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was chosen in the battle of the ditch, of the Ahzab, the parties, to do something intelligence mission. The mission which is used at the time, it was a mission impossible. Yes, by the description, it was a mission impossible. He describes that later on, he described that later on, when one of the التابعين, the generation after that, came and he said, والله يا عمي لو أن صاحبنا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما تركناه يمشي على الأرض ولا حملناه على أكتافنا. One of the تابعين said, والله, talking to حذيفة, والله my cousin, my uncle, if we would have accompanied Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam like you, we would not have left him to walk on the earth. We would have left him on our shoulders. We would, out of love, out of the respect, we would not leave him to walk on the earth. He said, my nephew, wait a minute. He did not face what we faced. And he started describing what an example for they faced. If you were with us on the night of the battle of the trench, you would have felt what we felt. It was a very dark night, very cold night, and it was a very windy night. The three: dark, cold, and windy. When the parties are in front of us, when the people of Mecca were in front of us on the other side of the ditch, and the people of the Jewish people of Banu Qurayza are behind us, and we are in between, and we're very much afraid, because our children and our wives used to be in our houses in the back, and behind them were the people of the Jewish, and we have encounters previous encounters with the Jewish people in Banu Qaynuqa, and now we had troubles with them, and we were very much afraid that the people, the Jewish of Banu Qurayda, might cheat us, and the people of Mecca are in front of us, and it was very dark. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made it at the time very scary situation, that no one of us were able even to, from the coldness, very cold night, that he said all of us were shivering, and I did not find anything to cover myself except just a cover of my wife that was not, I even was not able to cover my knees by it, and we're very cold, we're very afraid, and we're very hungry, we have nothing to eat. All of these factors combined together, and while the people of Mecca and the people and all of them are combining against them, and they know that everyone is against them, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to do an intelligence mission at this night, while everyone is afraid, is cold, and is hungry, and he sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood before the Sahaba, and before mentioning that, he said the hypocrites, not only just the people, the Jewish and our back, and the people of Mecca, even the hypocrites who claim you are Muslim, they start sneaking and leaving us one after another. وَيَقُولُونَ إِنَّ بُيُوتَنَا عَوْرَةٌ وَمَا هِيَ بِعَوْرَةٍ. They start giving the excuses to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, I would like to leave because I am afraid that my house and my children and my wife might be attacked, so I need to go and to protect them. And Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم used to give them the permission. Anyone who would come to him at this very terrible and very special situation, asking for a permission to leave the Muslim camp, go, Allah will be with us. Go, Allah will be with us. Go, Allah will protect us. Go, go, go. And he said, Hudhayfa said, 300 people. Many people from the people of the hypocrites left us, and they left us with just 300 people around Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. Just 300 people around Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in such a situation. At this moment, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood and said, "Man rajulun yatini bi khabar al-qawm." I need someone for you to go where? To go and to bring me to infiltrate through the people of Mecca and to know what they are planning to do and to come back to me. Oh, now someone from us in this situation, while all of us is very much afraid and it's very cold outside, and we are very hungry. Who will stand for it? No one commissioned himself to it. It was not easy. Don't say that. Why? Where is Abu Bakr? Where is Umar, the strong man? Where is Uthman? Where is Ali, the strong Ali? Where? It was very scary. It was very special situation, and you will never feel it except when you will be in it. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when no one answered him, he repeated again with another promise, مَنْ رَجُلٌ يَأْتِينِي بِخَبَرِ الْقَوْمِ وَأَتَعَهَدُ لَهُ بِالرُّجُوعِ وَأَضْمَنُ لَهُ الرُّجُوعِ. Who will go to bring the news for the people, and I promise that he will come back, so he will not be killed. I promise that he will come back. No one commissioned himself to it. For the third time, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم stood up. من رجل يأتيني بخبر القوم ويكون معي في الجنة. Who go to bring me the news of the people, and I give the promise that he will be with me in the Jannah. With me in the Jannah. It's not just the matter, the gain you will get in the dunya, that you will come back. It's a promise, you will not be hurt. But as well with Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم in the Jannah. صلى الله عليه وسلم. And Hudhayfa said, no one commissioned himself to it. And he صلى الله عليه وسلم walked among us, between us. And he said, he passed by me. It was very dark, and I was squeezing myself out of the coldness, and my cover is a very small cover, and I was shivering. And he said, who is that? Is it Hudhayfa? He said, oh, yes, I'm Hudhayfa. He said, come ya Hudhayfa. So Rasulullah meant Hudhayfa.
Is it Hudhaifa? Yes, I'm Hudhaifa. Go Hudhaifa and bring me the news. Hudhaifa said, I have nothing to do but to say sam'an wa ta'a. Okay, I will do it. I have nothing to do but to obey, but to comply with the command of Allah and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Hudhaifa said, subhanAllah, and listen to the details of that. And he said, and listen, and I will take a big lesson out of this moment. He said, when I started walking, فَكَأَنِّي أَمْشِي فِي حَمَّام. When I started just to walk, started my journey, my mission impossible. When I just stepped out of the tent, starting, I felt very warm, that as if I am just moving, I'm moving in a bath area which has all this hot weather. Bath area, just one minute before I was in the very cold inside the tent, but because I obeyed Allah and the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I commissioned myself for such a journey, I start feeling the warmth and the comfort. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, وَأَضْمَنَ لَهُ الرُّجُوعِ, and I promise he will be back. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported Hudhaifa radiallahu anhu arda. He said, I started walking till I arrived at the camp of the people of Mecca, and I started listening to what they say. But Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let me mention this statement, the commission statement, what he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commissioned Hudhaifa for. He said, go and bring me the news about the people, what they are planning to do, and don't do anything else from yourself. وَلَا تُحْدِثْ أَمْرًا حَتَّى تَأْتِينِي. Don't do anything else. Just bring the news, their plans, and don't do anything else. He said, when I arrived at their camp, and listened to one of the features, which one among the 10 features I had for Hudhaifa, how precise and how intelligent, smart was Hudhaifa radiallahu anhu arda. Abu Sufyan radiallahu anhu arda, at the time he was not a Muslim. He was a master of the polytheist of Mecca, who were camping at the time. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and look at that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the very fierce, violent wind on the people of Mecca, camping around, surrounding the ditch. Very strong wind, very cold wind, that wind, they were not able to hold the tent. It overturned their tents, their bowls, extinguished their fires. They were not able to light any fire to warm themselves, to make any food, to nothing. Was stable. Nothing was stable. The horses starting struggling, and the tents started being uprooted. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the fear and his soldiers to him. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُوَ وَمَا هِيَ إِلَّا ذِكْرَى لِلْبَشَرِ. No one knows who are the soldiers of your Lord except Allah. Who are the soldiers of your Lord? Could be the wind. The soldiers of your Lord could be the fear that he will throw in this heart, or the comfort he will throw in this heart. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent the stable sand underneath the Muslims in Badr, he sent the very shaky earth underneath the people of Mecca. Where is this is a soldier of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The earth is a soldier of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to part of it to be solid here and another part to be very shaky here. The wind is very, the soldier of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that he sent on the people of Mecca, so they were not able to live, to stay in their place. And the fear is a soldier of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Abu Sufyan, when he saw all of that, he said, addressing his people, my people, I would like to say a statement now. And it's a very special, important statement. And I would like to make sure that no one from outside us is here. That I don't like anyone from Muhammad's side to know about that. So, let every one of you to know who is beside him. Let every one of you to know who is beside him, that we can know that this is just our people. Hudhaifa radiallahu anhu arda was in a trouble. So if anyone will tell him, it's very dark, no one can see anyone else. But they know each other by the name. But if he will, if they will discover him, they will kill him, and his mission will be terminated. So Hudhayfa, the smart, the intelligent man, he said, I took the hands of the two people beside me and I started asking them, who are you? Who are you? So I did it. So I secured my side. So I made sure that they will not ask me. I asked them first, who are you? Who are you? So they responded, they replied, I'm this and that and this and that. So Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. He took it on spot. He thought of it and he reacted. And on spot, radiallahu anhu, very intelligent man, very smart man, on spot. The fear did not dismantle him. The hunger did not. But he's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala supported him. وَمَا يَعْلَمُ جُنُودَ رَبِّكَ إِلَّا هُوَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one. And this is why, do you know the slogan? وَهَزَمَ الْأَحْزَابَ وَحْدَ. Who's هَزَمَ الْأَحْزَابَ وَحْدَ? The one who defeated the Ahzab, the parties, by himself. Allah is the one who defeated the parties. Muhammad and the Sahaba did not fight the parties. And there was not any fight. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who sent the wind. The one who sent the cold weather. The one who sent the fear. So he the one who led the people of Mecca to terminate the mission and to go back in Mecca. وَكَفَى اللَّهُ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ الْقِتَالِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved the believers from fighting. Who did it? Allah did it. Subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Abu Sufyan at the time said, you people know that what we are facing right now, and we cannot stay as such. We cannot live here for any other moment, and I will start going back to Mecca. So let every one of you follow me. And Abu Sufyan, the leader of the polytheists after that, at the time before his Islam, started moving, riding his camel and going to Mecca, and everyone joined him. And this is the end of the battle of the parties when they went to Mecca. Hudhayfa رضي الله عنه وارضاه, which is another feature, which is he is very precise, and his obedience, الطاعة لله ورسوله, his obedience was very precise, and his compliance with the order of Allah and رسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم was to the highest. He said, when I started looking at the people of Mecca, and I was able to identify Abu Sufyan in front of my eye, Abu Sufyan, the head of the people of Mecca, and I started putting my arrow in the bow and about to shoot him, and I remember the word of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, don't do anything else, bring me the news and don't do anything else. So he said, I put it back to obey Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He said, don't do anything else, just bring the news. Subhanallah, the barakah of the ta'ah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Allah is Abu Sufyan. After that, just a few years after that, accepted Islam and became Abu Sufyan. And the family of Abu Sufyan became after that Banu Umayyah, the one who did a lot for Islam despite the other parts of the mistakes. But this is Abu Sufyan. He used to be the one after that, one of the masters of the Sahaba رضي الله عليهم. With what? With the compliance to the command of Allah and Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. Listen to every one of us. When you hear if'al wa taf'al, do and don't do, when you know that is haram, don't approach it. Don't make that if Hudhayfa would say, but he said, don't make anything from yourself, but there is a chance for the Muslims right now, if I will kill Abu Sufyan, this is a big hit, this is a big advantage, this is a big win. No. You have been commanded not to do it, don't do it. Don't bring it from your mind. Comply right away to the command of Allah and Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, regardless whether you understand the wisdom behind it or not. Apply that in everything in your life. Apply that in the matters of halal and haram. Apply that in what you wear. Apply that in what you gain as a money, in what you expend from your wealth. Apply that in the way you deal with the people, in the morals. When you know that this is hijab is obligatory. سمعنا وأطعنا. There is no word in that. I don't have to have anything on my mind about that. وَمَا كَانَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ إِذَا قَضَى وَمَا كَانَ الْمُؤْمِنِ وَالْمُؤْمِنَةِ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَيَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It does not fit for a believer, male or female, if Allah and His Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, would decree a matter,
for them to have the choice in the matter.
When you get to know that this is haram to work in a place that's selling that, or that's a part of your income to be haram, avoid it. Don't qualify for it. I cannot find another job. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will help you to find another job. And so on, and so on, and so on. Apply that, and this is the barakah of the compliance to Allah and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Right? And Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu arda said after that, I came back after I finished all my journey, and I was feeling comfortable. Once I stepped in the tent, I started feeling the cold again. So, and I found Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam praying at night, so I came closer to him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I came closer to him, and when he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and I put my body beside his body, and he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he saw, he felt that I came back, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spread his cover on me while he's praying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So I felt the warmth being under the same cover with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. While Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he continued to feel the comfort while Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam spreading his cover with him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, till he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam can finish his prayer alayhi salatu wa sallam. Many lessons that could be taken from the incident of Hudhayfa and the Ghazwat al-Ahzab, and the battle of the trench, the battle of the ditch. I'll take just 2 minutes hearing from you. What do you feel about that? What lessons that you can take from this story of Hudhayfa so far, and the battle of the ditch? Huh? Who will start? Any lesson? How do you feel about it? Mahmoud? Nothing? It's a great story. Yes. Anyone here? Any lesson that you feel from hearing the story of Hudhayfa and the battle and the obedience to Allah and the Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? We need to take lessons our daily in our life. Mahmoud?
Just the fact that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam trusted him, and that means a lot, and trusting him with a secret, like the list of the hypocrites, and then he chose him to perform like a major task for Islam, and Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu, he didn't say no, he didn't fear the consequences, because he had his trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he took the word of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to his heart, and he actually performed the test, so it meant a lot.
Jazakallah khair. Put your trust in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a big lesson for every one of us. Put your trust in Allah's promise and Allah's word subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَفَحُكْمَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ يَبْغُونَ وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ مِنَ اللَّهِ حُكْمًا لِقَوْمٍ يُوقِنُونَ. Do they prefer the ruling of the jahiliyyah, the ignorance? And who is better than Allah in giving ruling? But it's for الْقَوْمِ يُوقِنُونَ. But for those people who يُوقِن, have the certainty, who are certain about that. جزاكَ خير. If you don't have any other comment, I will move actually forward with Hudhayfa. Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu arda did not participate in Ghazwat Badr, and there is another big lesson here. The only Ghazwa that Hudhayfa did not participate in it was Ghazwat Badr. Why? He said, me and my father were outside in Medina at the time, and while in our way back to Al-Madina, the people of Mecca who came to attack the Medina, Ghazwat Badr, and the outskirts of the Medina, who came to attack the Medina, and we met the people of Mecca, and they held us, they caught us, and they said, where are you going? They said, we are going to Medina, Yathrib. And they said, okay, you are going to fight with Muhammad? They said, no, we are just going to Yathrib. They said, okay, we can leave you, we can release you under a condition that you will give a promise that you will not fight with Muhammad against us. If you will give us a promise that you will not fight with Muhammad against us. They said, me and my father gave them the promise that we will not fight with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They released us, and when we arrived to Al-Madinah, we met Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and we said, Rasulullah, this is what happened, and we gave them the promise, and we would love to participate with you. It was still the battle was running. We would love to participate with you in Badr, in the battle. But we gave them the process, the promise. What should we do? And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, another lesson, he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, بَلْ نَفِي لَهُمْ بَعَهْدِهِمْ وَنَسْتَعِينُ عَلَيْهِمْ بِاللَّهِ. We will fulfill our promise, our covenant with them, and we will seek Allah's help on them. Don't join us. Don't join us in the battle. We would like to help. Don't join us. You promised. These are the mushrikeen. Don't join us. Fulfill your promise. But we did not mean from our hearts that we will not participate with you just to be released. Don't join us. بَلْ نَفِي لَهُمْ بَعَهْدِهِمْ. We should be fulfilling our promises all the time. Even at the time when the Muslims will need you, like in the Badr, 314 Muslims against 1,000 of the mushrikeen. Even though, بَلْ نَفِي لَهُمْ بَعَهْدِهِمْ وَنَسْتَعِينُ عَلَيْهِمْ بِاللَّهِ. We will seek Allah's help against them. And this is why they did not participate in the battle of Badr, رجل أرضاه. Big lesson. Fulfilling the promise. Don't qualify for it. You give a promise for something, fulfill it. And even if this is will be, وَلَوْ كُونُوا قَوَّمِينَ بِالْقِسْطِ شُهَدَاءَ لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِكُمْ أَوْ الْوَالِدَيْنِ وَالْأَقْرَبِينَ. Stand firmly for justice. Witnessing for Allah, even if it will be against yourself, your parents, or your kinship. And this is why they did not participate in Badr. After that, they participated in Uhud. And another incident in Uhud, which will present another part from the side of Hudhayfa, which is the part of forgiveness. Al-Afu was safh. Forgiveness and burdening. And during the battle of Uhud, his father, Husayl, and another man, they were very quite old. Two men. And he said, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let them give them the excuse to stay in the Medina, not to join the fight, because they are very old. And Husayl رجل عنه أرضا, when the battle started, spoke to his colleague, the old man beside him, and he said, what are you doing? What are we doing? Are we leaving the battle and the fight and we are staying here? I hope that we would be honored by the Shahada, martyrdom. Let's go and join the fight. And both of them covered their face and joined the fight. The first man, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala honored him with the martyrdom on the hand of the mushrikeen. And Husayl, the father of Huzaifa, radiallahu anhu arda, when he was started into running into the battlefield, and while he was covering his face, the Muslims did not know him, and they thought that he is one from the other party, and they started attacking him. And Hudhayfa, when he was looking at them from far away, and he knew that his father, he started shouting, this is my father, but they killed him by error. It's an error killing that happened. And when Hudhayfa approached him, and after the killing happened, all the Muslims were very, very sad for that. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam even came, and they very sad for that. And Hudhayfa said, and listen, the same words that Yusuf sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to his father, his brothers at the end of the story, يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ وَهُوَ أَرْحَمُ الرَّاحِمِينَ. May Allah forgive you, and He is a merciful of all those who is the most merciful of all those who show mercy. May Allah forgive all of you. My father was killed. It was by error. My father, how about the shaitan will come to me and how dare you killing my father and I'm fighting in your side. يَغْفِرُ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ. May Allah forgive all of you. Not only that, but Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to the Sharia, collected the compensation at day, the compensation for the error killing, and he tried sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to give him the compensation for that. And he, radiallahu anhu, said, no, this is a sadaqah from me on the Muslims who are, I know that we all of us are in need, and this is sadaqah from me to for my father رضي الله عنه وارضاه. See, so he pardoned, he forgave what happened رضي الله عنه وارضاه. This is another side from the personality of حذيفة رضي الله عنه وارضاه. حذيفة رضي الله عنه وارضاه, he was not just the one who was entrusted on the names of the hypocrites, but as well he was very much aware of the hearts and the ills and the sicknesses of the hearts, and he fixed it. And he said رضي الله عنه وارضاه, the people used to ask رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم about the goodness. كان الناس يسألون رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم عن الخير, وكنت أسأله عن الشر مخافة أن يصيبني. Everyone used to ask Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم about the sources of goodness. How should I do to gain this hasanat? And what is the best of the deeds that can do to get hasanat? And I used to ask Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم about the sources for the mischief, the sharr, lest that it might affect me, it might hurt me, so I will protect myself from the mischief. I was asking about what are the fitan and the tests that would come. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Huzaifa said, made a khutbah or long speech one day from after the Fajr till the Maghrib on the same day, just breaking for the Salah, continuing and this giving this khutbah, describing everything that all the fitan and the tests that will come and all the disputes that will come till Yawm al-Qiyamah. And Hudhayfa said, many people attended that, and some of them lost it and others memorized part of it, and I did memorize it all. So Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu was one of the few people who knew about the fitan and the tests and the problems and the what that will happen, that will come after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam radiallahu anhu arda. So he knows what's the heart, and there is a hadith in which he mentioned that the hearts are four types, and he started describing the first type, the heart of the disbelievers who will have no goodness in it, and the heart of the hypocrites who will show goodness at the appearance, while from interity it's very bad. And the heart of the pure heart of the Muslim who will accept goodness and give goodness. And the heart of the regular Muslim, like all of us, have part of it which is in a good status and the part of it which is in a bad status. Part of it like the good tree that will get the water and will yield the good, that will lead a good fruit. And part of it which is a very bad weed that will not bring any fruit, good fruit. And whatever portion will overcome the other, the outcome will be. And all of our hearts are the four one. And I hope that we will be able to clean and cleanse and work on our hearts, that will upgrade it from this fourth type to the third type, which is the heart, which is a pure, clear all the time. Hudhayfa radiallahu anhu arda was very much aware of all of these fitan and tests of the heart. And he radiallahu anhu arda later on participated in all the battles. And at the time of Umar, he participated in the battle of Nahawand radiallahu anhu arda. And whenever Nahawand, which is one of the battles in the Persian area, combating the Persians al-Furs, whenever Nahawand is mentioned, the name of Nu'man ibn Muqrin, the first leader, will mention, and then the name of Hudhayfa ibn al-Yamani radiallahu anhu, Umar radiallahu anhu arda, when he commissioned the army to Nahawand, he said the leader will be Nu'man ibn Muqrin, and if he will be killed, the leader will be Hudhayfa ibn al-Yamani, and he mentioned seven of the leaders one after another. And they say, the people of the Persians used to be 150,000 in number. 150,000, which is very too much compared to the Muslims. That it was not even 20% of that, the Muslims. And he said, when the fight started, and Nu'man ibn Muqrin radiallahu anhu arda was one of the, got the martyrdom, and he got killed. And I was commissioned after him, but I made my orders to all the Muslims not to release this information, not to spread it that Nu'man was killed, otherwise it will affect the morale of the Muslims, and it will bring the more power to the people, the other side. So I covered this information and assigned another one from Bani Muqrin, which is the side, the brother of Nu'man. So when anyone will ask, who is leading Ibn Muqrin? Who is Ibn Muqrin? Nu'man or Nu'aym? He got the brother of Nu'man to be the leader, and he's working as the leader in command. It's not the dunya. I don't mind if I'll be a soldier or a leader or whatever. Umar assigned me to be the leader. But I will not take it on the appearance. I will work it on the ground. He got the brother of Nu'man, so to hide the killing of Nu'man ibn Muqrin radiallahu anhu, and he started looking and raising his hand and spreading the spirit of positivism in the Muslims. Allahu Akbar, sadaqa wa'dah, wa nasara 'abdah. Allahu Akbar, Allah will fulfill his promise, and Allah will support his abd Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he looked back to the Muslims and he said, Ya ashab Muhammad, and listen to this wonderful word, يا أصحاب محمد هذه الجنة وقد تزينت تشتاق إلى لقياكم فلا تطيلوا عليها الانتظار. Of the companions of Muhammad, this is the Jannah, the Jannat, which is yearning, looking, longing for you. Don't let it wait too long. Go and fight for the sake of Allah. And he started pushing the Muslims, pushing till Alhamdulillah, the Nahawand at the end of the day was for the Muslims against 150,000 of the Persians. After that, Umar radiallahu anhu assigned Nu'man, assigned Hudhayfa ibn Yaman radiallahu anhu the governor of Al-Madain, which is the capital of the Persians. And when they said that, and this is another part from the life of Hudhayfa, which is a simplicity, and he was very humble, a tawadu, and a simple, and a very simple man. Neither of the nothing actually will affect his heart. That when he was given, Umar assigned him as a governor for Al-Madain, Madain part of Persia. They used to have the all the kinds of a great position for their governor. When they saw Hudhayfa coming, the new governor coming, they saw someone riding an animal, and he's just releasing his head, his feet, and from the animal without any kind of glooming ride he's coming with, and he's just having a piece of bread that he's biting on it on while he's approaching them. And they started looking at him and saying, this is Hudhayfa? Yes, I'm Hudhayfa. Our governor? Yes, I'm your governor. And he, as a smart man, it clicked with him that they started actually thinking, comparing him to the previous Persian governors. And they say, Ya Ahl al-Madain, Iyakum wa al-Dunya, Iyakum wa mawatin al-Fitan. Be aware of the positions and the locations of the Fitan and the tests. And they, when they asked what are these mawatin al-Fitan, he said, the people to approach the people of the governance and the people of power, and to praise them of what they don't have, and to tell them what they don't have. And they got to know that we will have a harsh and tough man and ruling us. And when Umar radiallahu anhu arda, Umar was very amazing man. When Umar radiallahu anhu arda wanted to test him what the governorship made for him, he asked him, come on, I would like to speak to you. So he left Al-Madain and he went to Al-Madinah, and Umar sneaked for him, waiting for him, trying to look at how he will see Hudhayfa after a while, after he became a governor. And when Umar saw him in the same exact position and situation and the simple clothing, simple ride he's having, coming back after he became the governor, and Umar radiallahu anhu arda stood for him and received him and hugged him, saying, you are my real brother, and I am your brother. Alhamdulillah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not lose you by being tested by this, by the dunya or by the being a governor. Rajul anhu arda. Hudhayfa Rajul anhu arda was one of the very known features about Hudhayfa. He was one of the people who memorized the Quran by heart. Hudhayfa was one of the people who memorized the Quran at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they mentioned some, the historians mentioned some of the Sahaba who memorized the Quran by heart, among them from the people of Mecca, Abu Bakr, Umar, Uthman, Ali, Talha, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. These are the names who memorized the Quran by heart at the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Salim, Mawla Abi Hudhayfa, Abu Huraira, Ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Umar, Abdullah ibn Abbas, Amr ibn As, Abdullah ibn Amr, Abdullah ibn Zubayr, Abdullah ibn Aisha, Hafsa, Umm Salama, and from the Ansar, Zayd ibn Thabit, Mu'ad ibn Jabal, حذيفة بن يمان, أبي بن كعب, أبو الدرداء, أنس بن مالك. All of these are were among the people who memorized the Quran. حذيفة was one of them. حذيفة was the one who asked Uthman at the time of Uthman to collect the pieces of the Quran which is spreading around, which was the third attempt to collect the Quran, which is the last one. The first one which started at the time of Abu Bakr رضي الله عنه وأرضاه, and when he assigned Zayd ibn Thabit, and the second one was at the time of Umar, and the last one which is at the time of Abu Uthman رضي الله عنه وأرضاه, who completed the effort that started at the time of Abu Bakr and made all the Quran which we read now in one book compilation, and this was by the advice of Hudhayfa. When Hudhayfa came back from the conquests of Azerbaijan, and he saw the Muslims that because of the different Qura'at recitations of the Quran, he felt that it's very dangerous. If we leave the Muslims as such, there will be with the time different versions of the Quran, and he's aware of the hearts. Hudhayfa رضي الله عنه. So he went to Uthman right away before going to his home, and he said, Uthman, I advise you to finish the compilation of the Quran and to bring all the Muslims in one compilation of the Quran, and whoever would like to learn the different recitations of the Quran, it should be as advanced topic, but the Muslim, regular Muslims should know, should be combined on one version of the Quran, which is known now as al-Mushaf al-Uthmani, al-Rasm al-Uthmani. This is what Uthman رضي الله عنه وارضاه. حذيفة رضي الله عنه وارضاه died in the year 36 after Hijrah, after just 40 days after the killing of Uthman رضي الله عنه وارضاه. حذيفة رضي الله عنه وارضاه, when he came to die, they approached him. He was very, very much scared and tearing. And when they asked him, why you are crying? He said, I'm not crying out of fear of the death. The death is very beloved to me, but I am afraid what will be my destiny. Which day will be next day for me, whether it's a good day or a bad day. Do you have my coffins with you? They said, yes, we have the coffins. Let me touch it. When he touched the coffins, he found it very, very precious and very. He said, "No, these are not. I have no nothing in that. Bring me just two sheets. Just two simple sheets. Why? Because I will not stay in these sheets for long. After just a very short period of time, I will leave them either to a better or to a worse." A better in the Jannah, a worse in the Nar. So I don't need that. And he died رضي الله عنه وارضاه in the year 36 of the Hijrah رضي الله عنه, leaving a legacy of one of the major Sahaba of the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم, who was very elite, gave an example for the steadfastness, the obedience, the ta'a, the very smart, very talented Sahabi رضي الله عنه وارضاه, and for the one who was very strong in body, and combining all the features of the Muslim that we hope that we can have it. The heart is clean, the mind is very smart, the body is very strong, and as well he is very fit on the qualities of making ta'a to Allah and the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam till the last moment of his life. رجل عن رضاه. I have a lot to talk about Hudhayfa, but we'll stop here, asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant all of us the benefit of to listen to the word and to follow the best of it. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم, أستغفر وصلى الله على محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم.